Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Thank you. You may have your seats. It is a great pleasure, honor, and joy for my wife Angel and I to be here. My wife Angel sitting over there. And we'll be going on 27 years of glorious marriage, and we have three children, two dogs. We had a cat just died, and that was unfortunate, but nonetheless, we're just so grateful to God to be able to be with you this evening. We love Pastor Jim, Pastor Deborah Cobray. We love the family. We love the leadership team here and just this church. This church has been like a sister church to us at Cottonwood, and we have a great partnership with the Rock Bible College between them and our leadership college we have at Cottonwood, and it's just a wonderful partnership in God's kingdom, and that's the way it should be. We should be able to work together to do greater things for the kingdom of God and see more people come to Christ and see the body of Christ grow and discipled, and so we can reach the nations of the world. And so tonight, if you brought your Bible or your electronic device, could you please go there with me to Exodus chapter 14? Exodus chapter 14. I'm excited tonight to share God's word with you. I trust that you came expectant. And those who expect receive, and the expectancy that you have in your heart is the breeding ground for God's miracles that he wants to perform in your life. And so before we begin to read here and we talk about God's word from Exodus, I want to pray with you. I want to invite you to pray with me. Let's agree together before we go into the word of God. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we do honor your presence here. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for this great church that you have raised up, and this beacon of the gospel that you have placed here in San Bernardino in the Inland Empire. We thank you for every single person who is represented here tonight, and God, we just thank you that you're going to speak to every person. Open the eyes of their understanding. We thank you for the power of your spirit that is here not only to save and deliver, but also to heal and restore. And we pray above all things that Jesus, your Son, would be glorified. Thank you for giving me utterance tonight in the Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So in Exodus chapter 14, we find God's people, after they have been delivered from hundreds and hundreds of years of slavery in Egypt, they're free. God delivered them by an outstretched hand, his mighty arm, the 10 plagues that came upon Egypt, final one being the death of the firstborn. So they're free, they're gone. All of a sudden now, Pharaoh has it in his mind to go after and pursue the children of Israel. He begins to pursue them with his army, and the children of Israel are now at the brink of the Red Sea. And God instructs Moses to tell the people to go forward, and he has him stretch his rod over the water. The water departs, and now God's people are going through on dry ground. Pharaoh's army comes behind them, and they are killed because God calls the waters to come back upon them after the children of Israel had exited out of the sea by land. And so we find ourselves now in Exodus chapter 14, and I want you to look with me, please, at verse number 30 and 31, and then we'll skip into chapter 15. It says, "So the Lord saved Israel that day." Can you say saved, please? Saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt. So the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Chapter 15, verse 1. Then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord and spoke, saying, "I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation." Can you please say salvation? Salvation. "He is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him." We see here that after this great victory that God wrought for the children of Israel, they were rejoicing. And they had said that God saved them, that God had become their salvation. And because of that, they were rejoicing. There was joy. And it's somewhat of a type of the New Testament going forward of what it's like for us as Christians. Because Egypt is a type of the world. Pharaoh's a type of the devil. And we see them going through this Red Sea to where after they came through, everything in their past that had them bound was done away with. All of the army was killed in the Red Sea. They were drowned. And now they're happy. How many of you knew that it was a happy day when you gave your life to Jesus? I mean, that's a happy day. You have joy. You're so happy. You know that your sins have been forgiven. Your life has been changed. You have a brand new heart. You have a brand new start. You have a brand new name. Everything is different. You just love the Lord. And so here they are now. They're rejoicing. God saved us. He is my salvation. But then we find a bit of a change as we progress after this psalm. Look with me, please, in Exodus 15, beginning at verse number 22. And this is after they had rejoiced and they had sung about victory. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. Then they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. Now when they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah. And the people complained against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" So he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree. When he cast it into the waters were made sweet. There he made a statute and an ordinance for them, and there he tested them, and said, "If you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you." So, again, we see the children of Israel free from Egypt. We see their enemies drowned in the sea. We see them rejoicing. And now, all of a sudden, we see them in the wilderness. They're in this wilderness of Shur. And from this passage, we want to focus in on what God wants to help us understand about the wilderness. The wilderness is not something that is never mentioned in Scripture. It actually is mentioned, of course, besides here. The wilderness as a believer actually is a part of our journey. I know that's not something that makes you jump up and down, but the wilderness is a part of our journey in following after Jesus. It's not your destination, but it is comprised of a time and a period and certain experiences along the way as you're following God. You're en route to your destination. It is not a stopping place or a stopping point, but you do go through the wilderness. The psalmist said, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." God is always moving, thus God is always leading us, and God always has a place to get us to. Jesus, after he was filled with the Spirit, the Bible says, was led into the wilderness. In his ministry, Jesus would minister to people in wilderness-type environments, in deserted places. And one of the only miracles in the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which was the feeding of the 5,000, the only miracle recorded in every single one of the Gospels was it took place in the wilderness, in a deserted place. Wow. There's something about the wilderness. John the Baptist, the cousin of Jesus, the forerunner of the Messiah, he had his beginnings where? In a plush hotel in San Bernardino? In a posh hotel in Orange County? No, he had his beginnings in the wilderness.
He heard the word that God wanted him to preach. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He didn't hear that in a nice, beautiful service with beautiful people as yourselves in an air-conditioned building. He heard that when he was in the wilderness. So there's something about the wilderness that you and I need to learn. You see, this wilderness was a wilderness of Shur. The word Shur there from the Hebrew language means enclosed. It means a wall. So it was as if these people of God were in a place, a season, a time, a predicament where they felt themselves that they were blocked and locked in. And there was nothing for them to do. They came to some water because they had been thirsty for 3 days. And all of a sudden they found this water. They tried to drink it. They couldn't drink it because the waters were bitter. The waters were brackish. And they could not partake of the water. Now listen. Water is the single most important nutrient you need in your body. There is a doctor. His name is Dr. Don Colbert. And the first thing he does whenever he treats a patient is he makes sure he begins to give them water. And you may think, well, why is that? Because our bodies are 70% water. Our muscles are 75% water. Our brain cells are 85% water. Our bones are 25% water. Our blood is 82% water. I mean, we're like Aquaman and Aquawoman. We are made up of water. And listen to this. Your body, every day, everybody say every day. Every day your body loses 2 quarts of water. That's without you going to the gym and working out and lifting weights and riding your bike. Your body loses 2 quarts of water. Just so you get an idea of what that is, look, consider a 16.9 ounce bottle of water. Consider 4 of those. That's how much water you lose through perspiration and exhalation and you know, trips to the restroom. So you're always losing water. So you're losing water without even exercising. So these folks here were in a state of dehydration. And when you're dehydrated and you don't have water, which your body needs to function, things don't go as well. Do you know that people get dizzy because they're dehydrated? Some people have back problems because they're dehydrated. They have even done studies to show that people don't do well in math because they're dehydrated. I wish I knew that when I was not doing good in math in grade school. Nobody told me that. So it's important. So these people were experiencing this enclosure, this feeling walled in because of these bitter waters. Now, the word Mara means bitter. But the word bitter means angry, discontented, and heavy. You see, these children of Israel were not happy that they were thirsty. They were discontented because of lack of water. And here they are in this wilderness. See, when you're in the wilderness, beloved, it's a time when questions are many, but answers are few. It's a time when your supply does not match your demand. You're thriving, but you're not thriving, but you are surviving. You don't have all that you need, and yet the need is apparent. The need is great, and you can even feel the need as they felt it. And yet, you're in the wilderness. It almost seems mundane, like you're going through the motions and yet not actually moving. It's almost like just moving but not really going anywhere. How could that be? You're in the wilderness. They were in the wilderness and they were moving, but they weren't making any progress. They couldn't go anywhere because they had a lack of water. And maybe, just maybe, you're here tonight. And you feel as if you are in a wilderness as it relates to your health, your physical health, your emotional health, your mental health, your financial situation. Your marriage seems as though it's in a wilderness. You feel like you're closed in. You feel somewhat trapped, as if there's not an escape or release. You feel in your business that you're coming up against a wall, and you're making efforts to progress, to expand, to enlarge, to improve, to excel, and yet there is no progress made. You're in a wilderness. And maybe you're sensing dehydration, as the people did. This will lead us to point number two, which is this. The wilderness can cause spiritual amnesia. The wilderness, beloved, can cause spiritual amnesia. You see, although the need was great, although all the infants were thirsty, all the elderly were thirsty, they could not water their animals. Just a few days before, they were singing that the Lord is my salvation. God saved us. They had experienced the mighty hand of God, how he defied and proved he was sovereign over every god of Egypt. Those plagues were representative of the different idol worship they had in Egypt, and God was sovereign over each and every one of them, and he proved himself to be so. And they saw the mighty hand of God. Yet all of a sudden now, they couldn't remember the power that was demonstrated. They couldn't remember the Red Sea that was right in front of them. All of a sudden, the breath of God that he breathed into Adam's lungs when he became a living soul, they couldn't believe, they couldn't understand that same breath poured the Red Sea. Now all of a sudden they can't believe for some water. Are you with me tonight? And it's so vitally important that we not have spiritual amnesia and forget. You see, in your car, you have your front windshield, yes? And it's the largest windshield in the car, that plus the back. But inside of your car, you have a little rear view mirror. Now, if you have this beautiful front windshield, this beautiful back windshield, why would you need the rear view mirror? Because you see, there are times when you just need a quick reference to see clearly and closely what's behind you. You don't stare at what's behind you. You can't drive forward looking backwards, but you need something in close proximity in your remembrance as to what was behind you. And that point of reference helps you make a decision in terms of what's in front of you. And we need to be able to remember. When the shepherd boy David went to King Saul, and he told him he was going to fight Goliath, David's resume that qualified him to go and fight the 9-foot-tall giant was that he had a fight before that he won with a lion and a bear. Because he remembered what God did for him with the lion and the bear, he went with faith and confidence toward Goliath, because he knew the same God who delivered him and gave him victory with the lion and the bear would be the very same God who would deliver him and give him victory with Goliath. Do you remember your lion and your bear? Because your lion and your bear is what's going to cause your faith to rise and escalate so you can believe God. No matter how big Goliath may seem, God can knock him down. See, God is not just a God of the earth. God is a God of the universe. And God has all power. We must remember and not forget. The children of Israel forgot how God delivered them, how the angel of death passed them by, how they left Egypt's land with over 400 years of back wages, silver, gold, possessions, and they left Egypt with all of that. And God did that for them. The Bible even says that when they left, they ate the Passover lamb. And according to Psalm 105, there was none feeble among them. These are people who worked long hours. These are people who worked very hard. These are people who didn't have great diets. And yet, when they left out of Egypt's land, they were strong. Why? Because of the lamb they partook of. And that was supernatural, and that's what God did for them. But they just somehow, just 3 days, they forgot. And it'd be so easy for us to look at the children of Israel and go, man, those guys, oh, that's terrible. They're so bad. You know, makes you feel like you want to tweet about them. How could they do that? And yet sometimes we find ourselves in the same situations. God has healed. We have a testimony. We look in the rearview mirror. Yeah, God has healed before. Yes, God has provided before. Yes, God has delivered before. Yes, God has restored a relationship before. And somehow we forget. I believe that this is why part of the Holy Spirit's ministry is to bring all things back to our remembrance. Why? Because somehow we have a tendency, because of the fall, to forget. Thank God for the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Has God ever helped you? Yeah. Has God ever answered your prayer? Yeah. Do you know of any person who's been healed by the Lord's power? Yeah. Has God ever given you clarity when you were completely confused? Yeah. Has God ever strengthened you when you felt so weak and you couldn't take one more step? I'm telling you, God, if he did it then, he will do it again. He is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He said, I am the Lord, and I change not. But you may say, well, brother, well, how would I know if dehydration, so to speak, has set into my soul and you know, I'm forgetting, I'm experiencing spiritual amnesia, how would I know that? You would know it the same way that we know it about the children of Israel, because they began to complain. They began to complain to Moses. What shall we drink? It wasn't a one-time inquiry. It was a repeated, what shall we drink, Moses? What shall we drink? Moses, Moses, what shall we drink? What shall we drink? Moses, we're dying out here, buddy. Aren't you supposed to be God's man? Use the stick. What are we going to drink? Do something. Moses, Moses, Moses. And Moses didn't know what to do. He just kept hearing all these complaints. And these complaints led him to some action, which we'll get to in a moment. But let me tell you this, and here's my third point. There are some things that God wants us to know when we're in the wilderness. He wants us to know what to do, and he wants us to know what we should expect when we're in the wilderness. God wants us to know two things. Number one, what we should do. Everybody say, what we should do. And what we should expect. The first thing God wants us to do in the wilderness is this, beloved. God wants us to learn to trust him. To learn to trust him, not trust in people, not trust in institutions, not trust in our pedigree, not trust in our diplomas, not trust in any other thing or any other person except him. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Amen. You see, trust in the Lord. See, there's a beautiful picture here in that particular verse. Trust in, lean not. Trust in, lean not. See, we're not supposed to lean on our own understanding, because there's only so much you can understand. It's only so much you can know. See, the head doesn't know everything. There are things that you will know in your heart that your head will never know, because of revelation by the Holy Spirit. Oh, it's so wonderful. We need to trust in the Lord, have a confidence in the Lord, put your weight in the Lord. Right now, you're trusting in the chair that you're sitting in. If that chair only had, you know, one leg holding it up and it seemed kind of wobbly and it didn't seem secure, you wouldn't trust that chair. You would walk right past that and go find one that looks more secure and sit there. Why? Because you know you could not put your full weight on that chair. And God wants us to trust in Him with all of our heart. See, you put the word in your heart. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Put the word in your heart and let your heart lean inwardly on the word of God. See, on the outside, what we do is sometimes we go to people and lean on them. We call them up, we text them, we email them. We're always calling them, always going to them, always going to them. But we need to be able to go to God. See, the one you go to the most is the one you trust in the most. And it's so vitally important that we trust. See, trust is necessary when you know He can and you know He will. You just don't know how and you do not know when. There have been times where I have wished I've known, like, God, like, when? Can you tell me when? Like, I know you can. I know you will. I believe you. But when? And the clock keeps on ticking. I don't know if you know this or not. I have a wonderful, beautiful Timex watch here. And I like it. But the time on my watch is not the time on His watch. And when I'm thinking, Lord, how much longer? The Lord says, let patience have its perfect work so you can be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. See, you're lacking something. You don't know you are, but I know you are. And because I know that you're lacking something, faith needs to keep on working with patience so that you can be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Because God is more concerned about you being complete and being whole and not moving forward toward His destiny for you individually, for your family, and for this church. He doesn't want you going forward limping. He wants you to be whole on the inside. One of the most deceptive things is to see a tree that looks very big, and I've seen this before, and I've actually done this before, to see a tree that looks beautiful, big, and strong, to hit it, and then see it cave in. It's deceptive. It's not whole. Patience has to have its perfect work in our lives, making us perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Matter of fact, one translation of those verses over in James chapter 1, it says that when you fall into various trials, tests, and temptations, go ahead and count it all joy. In other words, have a party. It literally says, throw a party. Now, I know that's going to go across grain against your thinking, but that's faith. Have a party. Start rejoicing. Start singing the songs we were singing earlier. Lift up your hands, even though it feels like two demons are trying to hold them down. Lift them up in Jesus' name and shake them off like Paul shook the viper off into the fire and begin to praise God. Sometimes you've got to praise Him when you don't feel it. Sometimes you've got to push. You say, what does that mean? Push is an acrostic for praise until something happens. You've got to praise God. Keep on lifting Him up. Keep on exalting Him. Praise is the ordained strength of God. Sometimes you just need to break the devil's eardrums and give God a shabak. You need to give God a shout and let Him know that come hell or high water, I will not stop following Jesus. Just keep on going. Keep on praising, but we got to trust God. When you're single and you're trying to make ends meet and you're a single parent, you trust Him. He's a husband. You can trust Him. You can lean on Him. When you don't have a large income, seems like bills are more than, seems like your outgo is more than your income, you can trust Him. He shall provide. He shall supply all of your needs, according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. When you're not feeling his presence, you walk by faith and not by sight, not by your senses, not how you feel. And you trust him because you know he's good. You know he's faithful. You know he's got you in the palm of his hand. And no one can snatch you out of his palm. I have three girls. When I came back from the hospital after my first daughter was born, I had a movie play in my mind of her just growing up and getting older, and I knew some boys were gonna try to come around one day. This is the first day, you know, after she's born. I came home. Oh, Jesus. And then I started thinking of myself when I was young and not saved. Had to put that in there, a qualifier. Not saved, and I was thinking, oh, God. So I was like, okay, that's it. Nobody's coming near her. And there's a protective nature of a father over his family, his children, but especially, I think, if you have girls. And I would have that as an earthly father, and you would have that as parents of your children or as guardians. How much more your heavenly father when someone tries to attempt to mess with the apple of his eye? See, I love it. I love it. See, the devil fought that when he crucified Jesus, he thought he had him. All of hell was celebrating. It was a great victory for them. They thought everything was done now. It's like, okay, we can be rid of this guy. He's dead. They're going to just scatter. They're not going to preach anymore. This is great. This is wonderful. But the Bible says in 1 Corinthians, the second chapter, if the rulers of this world had known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Because they didn't know who they were messing with. And when you, when the enemy comes against you, he doesn't know who he's messing with. He's brainless, he's witless, he's stupid, he's a liar. He doesn't know, because if he knew, he'd back himself up right now. But we invoke the name of Jesus and we back him up and we put him on the run. Because God has given us that authority in his name. But we need to learn to trust God in the wilderness. Jesus was trying to teach his disciples this over in John chapter 6. And they were out there, as I said earlier in the message. And there were some hungry people out there. And they had been following Jesus. And he had been teaching them for about 3 days. And Jesus wants to teach his disciples. So there's a teachable moment there. So he goes, hey, Philip, where are we going to buy some bread so all these guys can eat? And Philip was, I don't know, even if we had 200 denarii, you know, it wouldn't be enough to feed all these people. See, Jesus knew what he was going to do, but he wanted his disciples to learn that even when you're in a situation and it seems like there are no physical, visible resources, if you have the source with you. I'm going to say that one more time because I don't know if that stuck in. If you have the source of all resource with you, then the source can give you the wisdom to know what to do to miraculously provide for what is lacking. Jesus trusted God when he was in the wilderness 40 days and 40 nights, no bread, no food. He trusted God. He didn't lean on anything. He couldn't lean on anyone. Nobody else was there. He was all by himself. And maybe you feel like that today. You feel like, man, it's just me. I feel like I'm in this all by myself. Hey, you're in good company. Jesus was there several times in his ministry. But in those moments, in those situations, you can trust on the one who is faithful and ever-present, who will never leave you nor forsake you. He'll be with you always, yes, even to the end of the age. And what God wants you to do, this is the same thing that Jesus taught us in Matthew chapter 4. He wants you to learn this. He wants me to learn this, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every single word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. You do not live by what you eat alone. You live by what you hear and by what you hear from the mouth of your Father. That's what you live by. So trust what he has said. Trust what he is saying. This is what God wants you to do, what's me to do in the wilderness. Just trust him. What does he want us to expect? Well, let's look in verse 25 and verse 26, please, of Exodus 15. So he, Moses, cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree. When he cast it into the waters were made sweet. There he made a statute and an ordinance for them, and there he tested them and said, if you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. God wants you to expect him to reveal himself in the wilderness. I suppose that if it was a place where all their needs were met and everything was perfect and everything was in order, everything was in place and there was nothing lacking, perhaps these individuals might not have seen or felt a need to watch God or look for God to do something and to reveal himself. But because they were in the wilderness, this is what God did. And this is the main thing God wants to do for you and I when we're in the wilderness. He wants to reveal himself. He said, I am the Lord who heals you. This is one of God's covenant redemptive names. Let me just kind of break rank here for a minute, and then I'm going to jump right back to the thought. But the first covenant redemptive name of God that he revealed to a singular individual was Abraham, the father of faith. Jehovah Jireh in Genesis chapter 22. The Lord will provide. Or literally, I am the Lord who has seen ahead and already made provision. Always know that God already has the solution before the problem ever arose. The solution was there before. That's why the scripture says over in Revelation chapter 12, Jesus was a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. Before God said, let there be, there was already a solution to the plight and fall of mankind, because God always has an answer before a problem ever comes. But this is the first revelation of God to a corporate people. And he reveals himself as, I am the Lord who heals you. I am the Lord your healer. I'm Jehovah Rapha, the Lord your physician. The word Rapha, or it could be also spelled Rophe, R-O-P-H-E, means to cure, repair, to mend, or to restore health. This is what God does. And when he says that he would not put any diseases upon his people that he brought on the Egyptians, it wasn't because he was trying to be mean. Listen very carefully. God gave Pharaoh, through Moses, a directive and a command. Let my people go that they may serve me. And Pharaoh continued to disobey the clear, clear word of God. And because of his rebellion toward the word of God, the revealed, clear, spoken word of God, he opened up the door of judgment upon himself. And that's why disease was brought upon them, because he did not take heed to the clear, crystal clear word of God. That's why that happened. So here we are, and God is revealing himself now as their healer. And it just makes me think, according to the whole chronology of the story, that if this is a type of like salvation and we're saved and then God is my salvation, according to Exodus chapter 14, the first revelation that God wants us to know after we're born again is that he's also our healer. Yeah. We get prayer requests every week at church. Bar none, the majority of those requests are for physical healing. Because there is always seemingly an attack or a situation or a condition or something happens, an accident, and there's always a need for wholeness as it relates to our bodies. And God is speaking to a people who have been bruised and battered and mistreated and abused and taken advantage of, and he wants them to know, I'm going to take care of you. But it kind of bewildered me a little bit because I'm thinking, Lord, you're revealing yourself as a healer, but there's not anybody who's really saying I'm hurting physically. What the issue is, what the subject is of discussion here is the fact that the waters are bitter. So why are you revealing yourself as healer? And we're talking about bitter water that people just can't drink. Here's the reason, I believe. Because water is life. Water is life. When Jesus had an encounter with the woman at the well in John chapter 4, he spoke to her, and the subject that connected them was the fact that they were at the proximity of the well, number one, but also the subject of that, because the well is nothing but it was in the well that brought them to the well, which was water. And Jesus spoke of living water. The water that I shall give you will become in you a well or a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. So Jesus, our Savior, types eternal life with water. He then speaks over in John chapter 7. On that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of what? Living water. So he refers to salvation as water. He refers to the Holy Spirit as his power being that of like rivers of living water. So when he reveals himself to his people and they needed water, he showed himself as a healer. They could not drink the water. Listen. Therefore, they were enclosed. Therefore, they were held back. They could not go forward. Because they could not drink the water. Listen. Sickness and disease can be like this. It can bring a sense that your life is lived behind a wall, that there are certain things you're unable to do, certain things you cannot have, eat or drink, certain places you might not be able to go. Certain activities you cannot partake in. It's like that. There's four of us in our family. I have an older brother. It was my older brother, sister, and then me. And my oldest sister, her name is Stephanie, she was born with a disease called sickle cell anemia. Sickle cell anemia, at least back when they were taking statistics in families, was a disease that if you had four children and the two parents had a trait of it, one of those children was going to contract the disease. My sister Stephanie was the one who contracted that particular disease. Sickle cell anemia is something to where your white blood cells turn like sickle-shaped. Your blood cells are circular. So when they flow through your veins, they kind of roll and rotate off each other. But when they turn sickle, then it prohibits the blood from proper flow through the veins in the body. And it throws the individual into what is called a crisis. And they are in extreme, excruciating pain. So when my sister was two, the doctors told my parents she won't make it till five. When she was five, they said she won't make it till nine. When she was nine, she won't make it till 12. She won't make it till she's 15. She won't make it till she's 19. And the family just kept hearing this year and year and year. She was in the hospital all the time. And I would hear her crying and screaming with excruciating pain and feeling so enclosed and so helpless because there was nothing I could do. There was nothing my parents could do. They'd have to put her in a tub full of ice water, and she would scream and scream and scream. And they would put needles all in her body. And I saw what a sickness or disease can do to someone individually, but yet not even to an individual, because here's the truth. When someone in a family is affected, it affects the entire family. Financially and in other ways. Some of you who know me know I play basketball. And I was blessed to get a scholarship to college and play and travel and do all this kind of stuff, and was going to go and play overseas professionally, but Jesus intersected my life and said, I have something else I want you to play. And so it's called gospel preaching. And so so doing that. But I remember as a kid thinking this very thought, I'm going to get a scholarship so I can go to college because my family cannot afford it. Because the finances are just too tight because my sister was sick so much. And so when we talk about enclosure and feeling walled in the context of God revealing himself as a healer, that's just an example. But here's where things turn around. Again, the people were dehydrated. They had spiritual amnesia, and they complained. But here's what Moses did, and here's what we can do. Moses cried out to God, and the Lord showed him a tree. Now, there's two ways to look at that. That tree, you could look at it as this way. Number one, that tree was there. God showed him that tree, and all of a sudden, he saw it. You could look at it. Number two, the tree wasn't there, and all of a sudden, God had the tree be there. Whichever way, he saw the tree. That tree is a type of the cross of Calvary. And when Moses applied that tree to the bitter waters, those waters were made sweet. And when we apply the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross to whatever situation seems bitter in our lives, whether it's emotionally, physically, financially, in our families, in our workplace, whatever is going on in your life, the cross will make whatever is bitter become sweet. Jesus will heal your body. Jesus will heal your mind. Jesus will heal your family. Jesus will turn your financial situation around. Open up the windows of heaven. Pour out such blessing you won't have room enough to receive it, because that's just how good Jesus is. For God made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Jesus Christ died on the cross. They wounded him. He was wounded for your transgressions. He was bruised for your iniquities. The chastisement for your peace was upon him. And by his stripes, the Bible says that we are healed. You may feel sick today. You may feel horrible. Maybe you have even thrown up today. But I want to tell you what God says about you. God says that you are healed. You're healed. So how do we apply that very practically? And then I want to pray and then come to a close here. We just apply it this way. God says a few things in this verse in Exodus 15, verse 26. First thing we need to do is give attention. We need to listen to the word of God. You got to listen to the word of God. If you are sick, listen to the word of God on healing. If you have need, listen to the word of God as it relates to his promises of provision. But you need to give attention to the word of God. God said, listen. He said, take heed. Then the second thing he said is obey what is right in my sight. In other words, we need to act. When God speaks to us and we're listening to the word of God, then we need to act on what it is the Lord speaks to us from his word. And if we act, then we're in accordance with faith, because faith is always an act. And then lastly, we need to affirm. We need to say what God says. God says, I am Jehovah Rapha, I'm your healer. We need to say the same thing that he says. See, the word of God is like a two-edged sword. And when God speaks, it's like truth being on one side of that sword. And when we say it, it's like truth being on the other side of that sword. And we need to say what God says. The Bible says in Amos 3:3, can two walk together except they be agreed, or except they say the same thing? If we want to walk with God, we've got to say what God says. If God says he's our healer, then we need to say, Lord, you're my healer. If he says, I'm Jehovah Rapha, I'm your physician, then we need to say, God, you are my physician. You are my healer. You're the one who cures me. You're the one who mends me. You're the one who makes me whole. So we need to say it, and God will do great things. So I pray tonight that you were somehow encouraged and that the Lord spoke something to your heart that would edify you, that has built you, that has lifted you, that has strengthened you, that has given you something that you can not only use for yourself, but maybe even give away. Now I'd like to ask if someone can come and join me on the keyboard. And I'd like to ask, would you please be so kind as just to bow your heads and close your eyes right now? I just simply want to give an opportunity, give an invitation for somebody who is here tonight. And you might not have a relationship with God. Maybe you've come to church before. And if you live out in this area, this is a great church to come to. But what I'm talking to you tonight about is not so much just joining this church, and this is a great church, as I've said. I'm talking to you about having a relationship with God. You see, when you look up at the stars at night, you know that they just didn't appear there. When you see some of the beauty of creation as you have seen, something tells you someone made this. When you think about your own life and you've seen how you have maybe blundered and stumbled and fallen and made some mistakes and you try to do good and yet you keep doing wrong and you feel empty on the inside and you don't know why and you've done the self-help thing and you've tried to do positive thinking and you've maybe done some religious rituals and you've tried to better yourself, but yet there's still a grand canyon-sized hole on the inside of you. And the emptiness is so loud, you try to drown it out, sometimes with drinking, sometimes with drugs, sometimes with relationships, or the pursuit of position, power, or possession, and it's wearing you down. Or maybe you just are a person who's never had any religious or church experience at all. But you find yourself in here tonight. I want you to know that behind the scenes, there's a loving, merciful, and gracious Heavenly Father who's orchestrated this time for you tonight, that you could come into a relationship with Him. He loves you so much that He's not going to allow mankind to stay separated from Him because of something called sin. There's God who is holy. Then there is mankind, first man and woman, Adam and Eve. They sinned. Then it was God, sin, and then mankind. And so what God did, because He so loved the world, is He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross in your place and in my place to pay the penalty and the wage of sin, which is death. So then there was God, and then Jesus was in the middle on the cross, and there's mankind. And because of His resurrection and His victory over sin, all your sins are forgiven. All my sins are forgiven. And so the only person between you and God right now is Jesus. And you have a decision to make about Him. You can accept Him, which is the one I would recommend, or you can reject Him, which is the one I would strongly, strongly, strongly not recommend. Because He has come to give you life, and that more abundantly. He's come to give you peace. He's come to restore what was broken between God and man. He is the answer to your heart's cry. He is the fulfillment of your deepest need, want, and desire that you'll ever have. You think you need a man or a woman, and if you're single and you want to get married, that's great. That's a desire of God. However, I'm telling you, what you want or need even more than a person in your life is Jesus Christ. You need Him. He's the beginning and the end of your search. And I would be honored and privileged to pray with you tonight to make a decision, as so many in this building have done, to invite Him into your heart to be your Savior and your Lord tonight. I am not offering religion to you tonight because religion is cold, it's clinical, it doesn't help anybody, it's all external. What I'm offering to you is a relationship that's living, that's breathing, it's alive because the God who ordains it is alive. He's real, and He's reaching out to you. He loves you. I'm going to count to three. When I say three, if you're here this evening and you want to invite Jesus Christ into your heart to be your Savior and your Lord, you want a personal relationship with Him, I want you to shoot your hand up high, and I'd like to ask you to please do it quickly. And maybe you're here tonight, and you've walked with Jesus for a while, but you've gone away from him. You're like that prodigal son or prodigal daughter. You know who you are. I don't have to talk long to you about that because you know what that's like. To know the truth yet not live in it. And I'm not just talking about doing better spiritually. I'm talking about you've separated yourself from God. Maybe through bad decisions, sinful choices, or wrong company, and you find yourself in a far-off place from his presence, and you're feeling the emptiness of that. But yet God is still reaching out with his heart of compassion towards you to restore you. And the good news is this, he loves you and he is not mad at you one bit. He just simply wants you to come, but you have to repent and turn around and come back to him and restore. Let him restore that which has been broken in the relationship so you can have sweet communion with him once again. I'm going to count to three. I want you to raise your hand up high. Either for number one, I want to invite Jesus Christ into my heart for the very first time, or number two, I want to recommit and rededicate my life to him. Ready? Here we go. One, you're not here by accident. Two, he loves you so much. Let him win the struggle and the war for your heart. Three, go ahead and raise your hand up high. Anywhere and all over the auditorium, if this is you and you want to respond to prayer. Looking, I think I see one hand back there. Praise God. Is there another? Okay. You can put your hands down. I'm going to lead you into this prayer right now. I want you to repeat these words out loud after me. Mean them with sincerity from your heart as you're talking to God and not to anyone else. Here we go. Repeat these words out loud after me. Congregation, let's pray with them to encourage them. Say, dear God, I come to you tonight and I admit that I've sinned and fallen short of your glory. I believe with all my heart that Jesus Christ is your Son, that you raised him from the dead, that he is alive right now. Jesus, I confess you as my Lord. My life is now in your hands. Thank you for saving me and making me a new creation. It's in your name I pray. Amen. Now, I'm going to go to my seat here in just a minute, but I want to just do one more quick thing. And those of you who responded as they close the service, I'm sure you're going to get some other instructions in terms of what you can do. But those of you who might be sick in body tonight, I just want to pray for you right where you are, but I'd like to just know who I'm praying for. If you wouldn't mind just quickly standing to your feet, if you would desire a touch from God tonight, I just want to pray for you. If you're sick in any way in your body, maybe even in your heart, Jesus heals the brokenhearted and binds up all their wounds. I just want to pray for you, okay? Why don't you go ahead and lift up maybe one hand toward heaven just to know that your help comes from him. Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, in simple faith, we ask you right now to stretch down your hand to heal all these who are standing in your presence. Let signs and wonders be done in the name of your holy servant, Jesus. You are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord, our healer. I thank you that you heal all cancers, all diseases, all sicknesses, all blood diseases, all aches, all pains, every infirmity. I thank you there is nothing that has been diagnosed medically that you do not heal. We thank you right now for healing by the power of your Spirit. Holy Spirit, thank you for infusing your life into every single body from the very top of their head to the very sole of their feet. Thank you that divine life and healing virtue are flowing, working right now in them, affecting a cure. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, can you go ahead and give Jesus a praise? Thank him for your healing by faith.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.